All right, guys, it's good to be here this morning. Rob, thank you for being here. God bless you. I've had death in my family this week. My oldest sister's husband passed on Friday. He was a big, strong man, and he had some pneumonia about 15, 16 months ago. He was treated with something in it. Lungs were scarred, and he got on the lung transplant list, and then they took him off. He didn't qualify, but he went straight down. And so pray for my family, okay? It's times like this when you realize how utterly helpless you are apart from prayer. Prayer is our superpower. You say, does a Christian have superpower? Yes, we do. We have prayer. And so we pray. Certainly, the posture of prayer is always to be, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. That's the posture of prayer. Sometimes we think about the posture of prayer. We talk about, do we stand and pray? Do we kneel and pray? Do we lay down and pray? You see people praying in all sorts of postures in the Bible physically. You know, they lay up, prostrate themselves. They stand up with their arms raised to heaven. They look up to heaven. They get on their knees. They fall with their face to the ground. You see people praying in all sorts of physical postures in the Bible. But the spiritual posture is always, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. This is what Jesus taught us to pray. That's the spiritual posture. We are in no place to make demands upon God. We know that God, we know that we can't, we know that God can, so we ask him to please do. He has a will that goes beyond ours, and we ultimately learn how to find ourselves in God's will and adjust to his great will and his great purpose in everything, and we can have joy in the Lord in times like that. Warm tears may roll down your face, but joy still is in your heart because God is a sovereign God who's on the throne. He has absolutely prerogative, and we resign ourselves to that. I've been learning this poem called Believe Good Things of God. The devil wants you to think negatively about God. We are prone to think negatively about God. You might not know that about yourself. We're prone with a sort of a fear complex of God. Like when Adam and Eve sinned, the first emotion they had was fear. Perhaps shame, then fear. And when God came looking for them, right? Not like God didn't know where they were. They didn't know where they were. But when God came after them, I might say, not looking for them, they beat it for the bushes. They're thinking negatively about God. Man thinks negatively about God. The devil wants us to think negatively about God, wants us to think lightly about God. And so it's when we take the word of God in our hands and we begin to read and God reveals himself to us through the word of God, through what he has given to us in his revelation of himself, disclosure, which is of the Lord, and we see him for who he is, and we have to gird up the loins of our minds and pull our minds tight, cinch it up, like they did when they got ready for action, when they'd cinch up their flowing robes so they could run and engage and things like that. And we have to do that with our minds to make sure we think good thoughts of God so that we don't impugn God or accuse God or just walk around sort of with a negative idea about God. Life is full of what ifs, why, and why not. Life's full of wouldas and shouldas and couldas. Why's, why not? And it's precisely in those places where the devil will make us, would tempt us in the old fallen flesh, susceptible to it, to begin to think negatively about God. That's why you have so many people, I don't believe in God. Listen, it's not that they don't believe in God, they're just mad with the God they know exists. They're mad with him for some reason, right? Hey, my baby sister died when I was, what is it? Or somebody drowned, or somebody's a house fire and killed. You gonna tell me? You follow what I'm saying? That's just this idea of where was God? Job had the right idea. Shall we just receive all blessings from God and not understand it from a sovereign hand comes dark threads that are needful in the skillful hand of the weaver? Right? All sunshine, no rain does not make a garden, makes a desert. God knows this. So we have to think good things of God. Let me see, can I say this poem? Help me out now. Y'all can't help me. Y'all don't know. Y'all got nothing. Look at that. It goes, yeah, thank you. It goes like, that's a superpower. It goes like this. When in the storms it seems to thee that he who rules the raging sea is sleeping, still with bended knee, believe good things of God. When you have searched in vain to find the silver thread of love entwined, in life's oft-tangled web, resign to believe good things of God. Should he smite thee till thy heart is crushed beneath the bruising smart, still while the bitter teardrops start, believe good things of God. 'Tis true thou canst not understand the leading of thy Father's hand, but trusting what his love has planned, believe good things of God. He loves thee. In that love, confide. Unchanging, faithful, true, and tried. Let now joy or grief betide, but believe good things of God. You cannot raise your thoughts too high. As spreads above the earth the sky, so his thoughts, thy thoughts outvie. So believe good things of God. In spite of what thine eyes behold, in spite of what your fears have told, still to his gracious promise hold. Believe good things of God. If in your heart you can believe, you shall in his good time receive. We cannot half his love conceive. So let's believe good things of God. Ain't that true? Well, listen, quoting the poem, I got it right, okay. Listen, we have to discipline ourselves to believe good things of God. And, you know, the ups and downs, the stiff winds, the gentle breezes, all the vicissitudes of life, to believe good things of God. In 1 John chapter number 1 and 2, where we've sort of stalled, but we are been looking at the business of fellowship, and as I pointed out last week, the Bible teaches in 1 John that this is a fellowship that is a living fellowship. A living fellowship is around the life of Jesus Christ, that life that is shared with all of us. There's only one life to live, and he that hath the Son hath that life, and he that hath not the Son of God does not have that life. Only one life to live. So the Bible teaches about that throughout the New Testament, that in that life we are unified. In fact, the Bible says in the book of Ephesians, chapter number 4, we are to endeavor to keep the unity in the bond of peace. The unity of the Spirit. We have this unity in Christ. We don't make it up. We don't get together and, you know, rah, rah, rah. No, no, no. It's not conjured by man. It is a unity that is firmly fixed in the person of Christ. And I'm to endeavor with everything I have to keep it in the bond of peace. But we have it. Like my wife and I. We have unity. We might fight like cats and dogs, but we got, right? We have unity. We are one. That don't depend on how I feel this morning. Doesn't, you know, unity is firmly fixed in Jesus. So we don't come together, we're gonna, you know, try to get unity here. You can go to the Rotary Club and get that. Exchange Club. We're going to try to surround around. No, no, no. Our unity is that we have one life. And Christ is that life. Our issue is we don't endeavor to keep the unity in the bond of peace the way we ought to. That's the issue. Therein lies the problem. We don't endeavor to keep that unity the way it's supposed to be kept and guarded. We allow too many other outside forces, outside influences, outside news and noise and nonsense cause us to hate the people we're supposed to love because we share one life. So that in that same passage over in the book of Ephesians, the Bible says we endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Right? There is one body. Now watch this. This is a sevenfold unity. Only one body of Christ. We have one Spirit. We have one hope. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. One God and Father above all, who's through all and in you all. Seven. It's perfect unity. Body. Right? Spirit, hope, Lord, faith, baptism, Father. One. So it is, so this fellowship is a living fellowship. It is to be a joyful fellowship that we share these things right way under you, that you might have fellowship with us. Truly our fellowship is with the Father and with the Son, Jesus Christ. We write these that your joy may be full. There's joy in this fellowship. There's joy in this fellowship. One of the ways you keep the unity of the Spirit in a bond of peace is someone taught me years ago, and to have this joy is Jesus, others, and you. You've heard that. Jesus, others, and you. You get that formula mixed up, you're going to mess up. You're going to mess up the spirit of the unity, the bond of the unity. When Jesus is first and others is after Jesus, and then put yourself last. Now, you know we're not prone to that. You know you're not prone to that. So you want to talk about fellowship? It's Jesus, others, and you. I'm not prone to that. I mean, I'm prone to be first. And I'm prone to just talk about Jesus. Because I know Jesus, I have to put up with y'all. That's how y'all think. That's how we think. But when Jesus is first, when Jesus is really first, you can't help it. Others has to be next. The Bible talks about it in the Philippians chapter number 2, esteem others as better than yourself. In a world where self-esteem and self-realization and pride of this, that, the other thing, you know what I'm saying? This whole idea of esteeming other as better than yourself, that's otherworldly. And it is absolutely, certainly not of the flesh. It's completely, completely of the Spirit. So it is a living fellowship, a joyous fellowship, right? And by the way, that's where joy comes. I'm going to tell you this right now. Real joy is when Jesus is where he's enthroned, where he's supposed to be. He's on the throne and I'm on the altar. When the Lord is on the throne, I will be on the altar. When I'm on the altar, then I can esteem other as being better than myself. Not unless and not until. But I don't mentally muscle that into place. I have to. That is a work of the Holy Spirit that I must surrender to. I must realize the truth of it and then surrender to the Holy Spirit of God who's working based on His Word, based on God's desire to sanctify me, to bring me to that place. And He's operating, so I'm what? Cooperating. That's the operation of the Holy Spirit to do that, then what God requires of me is cooperation. And then we talked about an open and honest fellowship. It's open and honest, and I'm honest and open with you. And I'm open and honest with myself. You know, if I say that I have no sin, I have not sinned. I'm a liar. And I do not the truth. I'm not honest with myself. I'm in denial. That's delusional. We do it all the time. I mean, the Holy Spirit of God convicts us of words and attitudes and thoughts, and we brush them shoe fly. You know? We go on believing what we've always believed because we've always believed it, and there's not room for God to even break into that delusion. So, you know, this is one of the things I've learned through this past year, this pandemic, whether you believe is one or not. Doing this last thing in our, some people call it a plandemic, you know. I mean, you can hardly say a word without it splitting the room right down the middle. There ain't no pandemic. You can't. But one of the things I've learned over the year, through all of the issues about the mask or not the mask, and I say I learned learning the politics, you know. Maude Arbery or George Floyd or the Minneapolis, St. Louis, you know, you talk about all of this stuff in the pandemic and then the political year. Fox and CNN and MSNBC, they're all putting it on us. Like, I'm learning that we don't, as Christian people, don't believe this Bible half as much as we think we do. We just don't. Right? Anxiety and angst is the light on the dashboard that let you know you got a problem somewhere. The light ain't the problem. Check engine light ain't your problem. Your engine is your problem. Right? I mean, your oil light ain't your problem. And anxiety and angst and anger, these things point to something. Fear and dread, and this points to something. There's a light on the dashboard. Let me know I got a problem somewhere. We're not honest with ourselves. We're not honest with one another. You know, I'm asking people, and Lord help me to do it myself. It's easy to counsel and to, but help me to do it. I'm asking people to ask questions. One of the great ways to get people to open up is just ask questions. Ask questions of people. Hal and I have some disagreements. We have something between us. I don't know what might be there. It might be that he was, you know, he doesn't like short people, and I don't like tall people. Let's take the obvious thing. All right, let's take the obvious thing. Okay? He doesn't like my shoes. I don't like his shoes, right? I mean, let's take the obvious stuff, though. But if there's this difference, you know. If I would be wise, see, sometimes Christian people, we're armed with the truth, but not with wisdom. And all you got is the truth, and people, I'll put it down there because it's true. Still ain't wise. Wisdom is the proper application of truth. The proper appreciation and application of truth. You just can't go out into the world guns blazing because you got the truth, which you might not even have anyhow. You have to have wisdom. And as Jesus did, I don't even know what I'm talking about this morning. I ain't even on the text, but as Jesus did, you know, you need to approach people redemptively. If they're wrong, approach them redemptively. Right? And if you approach me redemptively, we disagree. There's a dead monkey on the line somewhere. Either I'm doing something wrong, you're doing something wrong, or we're both wrong. Or we're both right. Watch this. But we see it from two different perspectives. Do you know I can stand right here and you can stand right there and I can put a number on the ground and to me it looks like a 6 and to you it looks like a 9 and we're both right. You see what I'm saying? So ask questions. Approach people with a sense of redemptively. Like they can be, You know, they're not throwaways. People are not throwaways. I don't care who they are. So we're not allowed to write people off. I don't know. The Lord prayed for unity for the church, not, you know, that we might be one and that that unity might be kept in the bond of peace. He prayed for that. It was on his heart, that great high priestly prayer in John chapter number 17. Why is it not on our heart? Right? Why don't I give a damn? I mean, if Jesus prayed for it. Like, my goal is not to get us all up here roasting marshmallows and singing Kumbaya, oh, we're a band of brothers. Right? I mean, I love that song, Tim, but that ain't, we don't just unify around a song. We share the same life. Joy, and it has to be open and it has to be honest. And if we ever are, we can really enjoy the unity the way it's supposed to be. We can really make some differences in the lives of people who may be wrong about some stuff and need to be redeemed in some sense. Around in some sense. But we can't do it if we don't care about what Jesus says. We can't do it if we, you know what I'm saying, we line up with our hard lines with the people who just believe everything we believe. Can't do it. I don't care whether you're black or white, straight or gay. People need to be born again, and people need to know who Jesus is. And people be. We had a preacher come to our church on Sunday, and he preached on the God of the refugees. Today, we've made refugees and aliens a political bombshell, a political issue for the church. Not about politics. The church is about the mission God's put us on the earth to do. Okay? And the mission God put us on the earth to do sounds a lot different than what you hear many times in the pulpit and Christian people, because we think God's will for me to be involved with 1,000 things don't have a thing to do with the great mission and mandate of the church, which is the Great Commission, winning people out of a world. And I'm not to spend my time rearranging deck chairs on a sinking ship. God's called me to be rescuing people off the ship with the gospel. Doesn't mean that I can't. I'm armed with the gospel, so I don't know what anything else is about. I just need to be wise enough to know that people have things that they're fighting for and all of this. And those things are the devil is a liar. He'll keep you distracted so you don't give attention to the one thing that's needful, and that is to know who God is. So you run off of your gay pride stuff, your black pride stuff, my white power stuff, my right wing stuff, I'm a blue state, you're a red state. We run off with all that kind of stuff, and people are dying and going to hell. And the church is a part of that argument. We've made the refugee a political football. And God said to the nation of Israel, hey, you were refugees one time. You were in Egypt and you were mistreated. So he said, when you get in your land, you be good to the refugee. People running from other places, no opportunities, hot spots, people are getting killed and they don't have. Let me tell you what I'd do. I'd run too. So, I don't know, guys. We've made it. You know, Jesus was a refugee. Jesus went to Egypt. Somebody's trying to kill him. You know what he did? Ran. His parents took him to Egypt. He was a refugee. Abraham was a refugee. I mean, you look at David ran to the Philistines when he was Saul's trying to kill him, a madman trying to kill him. David had to run and flee to another land. Nothing new is in the Bible. So we've turned everything into this. I'm learning we don't believe this Bible. That's the problem. We don't believe this Bible. We're fighting about things that ultimately are not going to last anyhow. Just watch it in the Bible, how God, in his sovereign prerogative, he sets up kings and takes them down. He sets up kingdoms and takes them down. You follow me? This nation, world power, prominence, he'll put them down, raise up another one. Nothing new, just look at the scripture. So I know I'm talking about this a long time and a lot, but we're off base, and that's why we can't be unified in the thing that we are called to do. We're unified in Christ. We're not unified in our mission. Our mission is to be trying to win the lost. Instead, we've got people running around, make America great, Black Lives Matter, red state, blue state, this, that, the other. I got to talk about this stuff. And if it costs me my job, y'all want to get another person up here? Get them. I'm sick of it. God help us. We got to start believing this Bible. So it's to be an open and honest fellowship. Open, honest. God, it's me, it's me, it's me, oh Lord. I got issues. Yeah, it's you and it's me. We've got issues. The problem is us. So, hey, guys, as we talk about an open and an honest fellowship, you have to do it. You have to ask questions of each other. We still pretty much line up along racial lines and along cultural lines. We still do. The church is still not practicing this whole keeping of the unity in the bond of peace. We're not practicing that. If you are saved, you and I share one life. That's our living fellowship. If you walking with Jesus and I'm walking with Jesus, we will be sharing joy. And if that's the case, we will be, hey, listen, open and honest with each other. That never means that, oh, one day, oh, Harold and I are going to be, I mean, you know, now we've got to, everything's got to be exactly right. He's got to be, you know, what if we split our, the difference between our height, I guess I go up to 5'11", and you go up, you come down to 5'11". We're never going to be the same height. We're never going to write, I wouldn't wear those shoes. We're never going to be the, we're never going we're never going to have to do all that. That's all facade. Don't get the idea that unity and uniformity is the same thing. Not the same thing. We don't, you know, God's not trying to beat us to fit and paint us to match. There will be joy in our fellowship. There will be, you know what I'm saying? I'm talking about this man will love me and I will love him. He would be iron that sharpens iron in my life. I'll be iron that sharpens iron in his life. And sparks may fly and the heat may rise, but the iron gets sharper. Just like my wife and I, we have unity. We've been married for 42 years. She said, I said, I do. She said, you better. And so for 42 years, right, we've been living and loving and learning and laboring and lamenting together. Together. She has to be open and honest with me. Believe me, she is. Right? And I do the best I can with her. All right? You know how I'm saying. You don't have to say everything. Again, you can't just be armed with truth. You got to have wisdom. A guy's wife asked him, say, do these pants make me look fat? He said, no, it's them big old hips make you look fat. Well, now that was true, but it wasn't wise. He didn't have to say that. So everything you say. But that's a, hey, that you laugh, but that's a classic example of truth and wisdom. But listen to this, guys. If we're gonna sing, we're the Band of Brothers, if we're gonna say come here and we meet around this word, then I want to tell you something. I want that to be real. Not, it's got to be transparent. Got to be open. Got to be real. It's got to be, you know, engaging. It will not happen just because we come sit at these tables and we all hear. Certainly, this is the learning thing. But I'm gonna tell you, you got to step out of your comfort zone. Black people got to step out of their comfort zone. White folk got to step out of their comfort zone. You got to be able to engage one another and ask questions and learn. And people come from different places and different things. We all come with our junk. I understand it all. I mean, I understand the devil doesn't care how you get messed up or what you messed up with, as long as you stay messed up. He just soon you be drunk as a hooked on gambling or racist or a flaming homosexual or a upstanding Baptist. You don't care whether you how you get messed up. Self-righteous religionist. He doesn't care whether how you messed up, as long as you messed up. So he says, these things write unto you that you sin not. You've got to confess our sin. Right? We've got to confess our sins. And he says, I wrote this so you can see that how serious sin is to God. Acknowledge what it is when the Holy Spirit of God is doing his work. Acknowledge what sin is in your life. And it's not all about them and they and what they're doing. God is after what's God is after that issue with you. So I know I can sound like a Johnny One Note with this stuff, but, you know, this is where fellowship is. Fellowship. Not just two people, not two fellows on the same ship, but what? Two fellows sharing the same life. So, Father, we're thankful. Lord, my heart is not to sound like a lecturer up here lecturing people. God, I'm a mess. So, do that work in me and in each man. Help us to keep this wonderful unity that's ours. The bond of peace. Help us to recognize and relish the one body we share. The one Spirit, the one hope, the one Lord, the one faith, the one baptism, the one God and Father that we share. Help us to walk in such a way as to reflect your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Just in perfect men, a broken whole.